Stephen Alter appeared at a book signing in Mequon last week, and we're pleased to welcome him today on Upfront. Thanks very much for being with us today.
Hi, Mike.
Let's talk a little bit about the president and how he's doing today. And you and I read the latest polls, and they show that job approval is the lowest it's ever been. And my question, I guess, is it strictly a reflection of what's happening with the sluggish economy, or is there more going on there?
I think it's mostly the economy. I mean, if you've got 9.5, 9.7% unemployment, you're going to have problems. Ronald Reagan was as low as Obama at this point in his term because the economy was doing really badly in 1982. But some of it is that Obama is not a Reagan when it comes to communicating, and it's been a big surprise about him. We expected that he was going to ace communications, the silver-tongued orator, you know, and that he would struggle in executive leadership because he had no experience when he came to the presidency. And I found when I was reporting for The Promise that it was actually the reverse. He struggled to frame a message, and he continues to struggle to really connect with the American middle class. And yet, behind closed doors, or when it came to putting points on the board, as they call it, he's achieved a lot.
He has legislative accomplishments, whether you agree or disagree with him.
Serious right. Legislative accomplishments, which prevented a depression. I mean, the main thing that I think a lot of voters don't understand is that when Barack Obama took office in January of 2009, the American economy was losing 750,000 jobs a month. If we'd stayed on that pace, we would have been in another Great Depression by the end of 2009, without exaggeration. That we would have had millions of people unemployed and 20% unemployment instead of close to 10. But nobody really, or not very many people, credit that. It's an abstraction almost for him, and it doesn't help him to make that argument. It doesn't help him to dump on President Bush. He's in a bit of a pickle politically right now, and the Democrats are in trouble with him.
Well, it's interesting in this campaign swing, and here in Milwaukee, he was dumping on
the
Republicans and using the metaphor, and this seems to be the campaign theme.
Yeah.
They drove us into the ditch. We're not going to give them the keys back, the Republicans.
Yeah.
Is that an effective campaign platform for Democrats this fall?
I think it's a good one. I mean, it's not enough. It's necessary but not sufficient. But for August, it's a good one. And the thing that I like about that whole metaphor is at least you can remember it. One of the problems Obama has had is they haven't had the sound bites and the slogans that people remember. The Republicans have been more effective, more disciplined at driving a message. Al Franken, the senator from Minnesota, had a pretty good line about this. He said the Republican bumper sticker has one word on it. No. The Democratic bumper sticker has a whole lot of words ending with continued on the next bumper sticker. There was not a sharply framed message. So at least with this car in the ditch metaphor, at least it's something you can take away from an Obama event like the one in Milwaukee. You actually can remember that. And then he goes on to say that, and I think this helps him too, that when you drive a car, D for Democrat is drive and R for Republican is reverse. People do have to ask themselves the question of whether putting John Boehner, the congressman from Ohio, in charge of the Congress, he would become Speaker of the House should enough Republicans be elected. Is that what they want? What would he do? Most people don't know. I don't even feel as a journalist I know what the Republican agenda is. They haven't really laid it out. They've been obstructing very effectively. We don't have much of an indication of where they would take the country. Most of what they've said substantively is a variation on what we tried over the last 8 years, and it didn't work very well.
I want to go back to what you said about the communication skills of this president, because he did so well during the campaign communicating a message. But I read an interesting article this past week, Roger Simon with Politico.
He said,
could he be a one-term president if he gets that far? And he said he's whip smart, which you've pointed out in your book, but he doesn't get it. And he's not staying on message. He's not listening to his advisors. He's not following the polls. He's not doing the things a first-term president who wants to be a second-term president has to do. Is there truth in that, do you think?
Well, yeah, I'm not as pessimistic about that. I'm just kind of, and I know this sounds sort of like I'm taking a powder on it, but I just think it's too soon to know. You know, we're always asking our business, like, predict the future. A year and a half is a lifetime. So many external things could happen. So right now, I would bet that he does get reelected. But his basic approach is that which was illuminated by Mario Cuomo, the former governor of New York. And he said, you campaign in poetry and you govern in prose. And I think Obama has taken that lesson too much to heart. So we all remember he campaigned in poetry. It got him elected. And then he decided, look, when I govern, I'm not going to worry about the polls very much. I'm not going to play all the political angles. I'm not going to play a short-term cable news game. I'm going to try to play a longer game and deliver for people with all this legislation and then let the results speak for themselves. I think in some ways it's not a realistic strategy given the way American politics works right now. But in some ways, it's kind of commendable. You know, we all kind of say we want somebody who's going to be in there trying to do the job and not just be all political all the time.
Then we criticize him when he's
not political enough. But it is a legitimate criticism. At one point, the president said recently, this is not theater. The presidency is not theater. And I kind of, like, yelled at the TV, the hell it isn't. You know, the presidency's always been at least partly theater. But when I interviewed him for The Promise, and I talked to 200 people who deal with him on a pretty regular basis, you know, a lot of people on the White House staff and a lot of other people on Capitol Hill and in the agencies, and they all paint a picture of a not only a very smart and cool-tempered guy, but somebody who does have some kind of a longer-term strategy for how this fits together. And it just hasn't borne fruit yet. People also have to remember that in an off-year election, the party controlling the White House almost invariably loses seats. So it's in the natural course of things that this is going to be a big Republican year. How big, we don't know.
Two people in the White House take solace in the fact that there are fairly recent examples of presidents who've been in this position. You mentioned Ronald Reagan, Bill Clinton in 94. I mean, there are people who were not doing well in the polls and went on to be very successful two-term presidents. So they take some solace in that?
I think they do. And I think they have a lot of faith in his ability to hit the three-pointer at the buzzer, as he's done on previous occasions. My concern about him is I don't think he's found the right tone, the right key to really connect to the American middle class. He's doing a little bit better with it, but the same cool temperament that helps him deal with these very complex problems that he faces every day, it seems a little bit too cool when it comes to connecting. And he's not a needy guy himself. He's very secure in his own skin. And so I think he doesn't quite understand that other people, not just, you know, members of Congress with room temperature IQs, but, you know, voters who want some comforting, that they're needy and they're hurting right now, a lot of them. And so he's a little too cool when he's in public. But I think he's trying to connect more. He doesn't want to become an actor, you know, and cry and do all these things that are phony, because he knows that authenticity is his calling card. That's his ace in the hole. That's what ultimately gives him a chance to be reelected, is that he doesn't seem like he's just another phony politician to most people. So if you look closely at the polls, people are unhappy with the way the country is going right now. They're unhappy about their economic condition. They haven't given up on this president. His personal approval rating is still pretty high, so he's not out of the game yet. And presidents have a lot of ways to reinvent themselves, to take external events and use them to their advantage. That's where he's been underperforming lately, though, is in being sure-footed in that 24/7 cable news culture that he's operating in. And he's got to bring up his game on that if he's going to succeed.
Quick question on the 24-hour cable news culture. The Moss controversy in New York, is that an example of the president wading into something that he really didn't need to be involved in?
I think he thought that that was a matter of principle. And personally, I think he's right. And I'm somebody who, you know, knew people who died on 9/11. I live in the New York area. You know, we can't go to war with a billion Muslims. And for people like Newt Gingrich to say, well, let's close every mosque in the United States until they let churches into Saudi Arabia, the point is we're not like Saudi Arabia. And there were Muslims who died on 9/11 in the World Trade Center. So I think on the merits, he was right, even though it wasn't the most popular thing to do. He was a bit ham-handed in the way he clarified his comments. His basic view, which I think an awful lot of people in the New York area share, is this is up to the community. You know, it's not whether I think they should build the mosque there or not. They have a democratic process. The community board voted 29-0 to locate the center there. It's good to bolster moderate Muslims. It's a great thing for us to do internationally to show we're on the side of moderate Muslims. He was entertaining Muslims in the White House, as many presidents going back to Thomas Jefferson have done. So I'm actually really happy that he didn't pander like so many politicians and blast the mosque. That would have been the easy, wrong thing to do, unless you want to have a war with a billion Muslims. I don't think any reasonable person wants to do that. And so he's, in his own mind, and this is something I've got a lot about in my book, he is not in a war against Islamo-fascists or Islam in general. He's very focused on Al-Qaeda. They're the ones who hit us on 9/11. And he has signed off on more of these targeted hits. Really, there are assassinations with these Predator drones. He's killed a lot more key Al-Qaeda targets than President Bush did, in part because of the technology, the drone technology, is improving, but he just makes a distinction between a billion Muslims and the people who actually did this to us, and I think that's the right distinction to make.
I want to get a quick question in before we run out of time here on Newsweek and the future of your magazine and website. How does that future look to you now with the ownership change?
Well, you know, I just actually met this past week with our new owner, whose name is Sidney Harmon. Harmon.
91 or 92?
He just turned 92, okay. But he is 92 going on 72. And I had a three-hour meeting with him, and at the end I was kind of wilting, and he was unbelievably sharp and is an exceedingly bright, successful guy. So I'm actually quite hopeful about the future of Newsweek now that we have a new owner, and we're going to have a new editor fairly soon. And don't count us out. It's a great magazine, and it'll continue to be a terrific read for people who want a fuller picture of our world.
Donovan Alter, appreciate your time. Thanks very much for being with us today.
Thanks, Mike.